Roman, talk to us about the past year in financing. The cost of capital has been low. Companies have been tapping into debt and equity financing. How do you see it playing out? Do you see that continuing? Will we see companies continue to bulk up?
Yeah, I think, Larissa, we'll see a couple of key trends continue. We have entered a period of lower costs of capital, both in terms of interest rates, corporate spreads, lending spreads as well on the bank side. And then from an equity perspective, we've got valuations that, you know, appear to be cyclically high, but, you know, we don't know where we are in that cycle yet. So nonetheless, there's a great deal of liquidity in the market. So I could see those trends continuing for the foreseeable future, until something changes that way. I think the other trend that we're currently, the markets are the beneficiary of, and our clients, the corporations are the beneficiaries of, is the acceleration of several business models and themes that the pandemic has brought forward, primarily in the technology sector as it relates to healthcare, telemedicine, e-commerce. You know, those trends have been very strong, as we all know, over the past few months. But, you know, they've emboldened several companies to accelerate their business plans and to seek capital in the capital markets.
You mentioned the tech space. What other sectors have been active when it comes to debt and equity financing?
Generally speaking, we have seen almost all sectors access the market, so it's hard to differentiate. If I was to look forward and to focus on those that we might not have seen in the normal course, it might be some of the technology companies that have come and made it to the public markets. You know, some of that activity driven in the U.S. through the SPAC phenomena in terms of bringing some of these mature tech companies to the public markets. But in the Canadian context, we've seen several Canadian companies that are in the tech space or adjacent to the tech space come to market very successfully. And as a result, success begets success in the mind of underwriters and clients. When they see other companies executing a successful IPO, they'll want to do that as well. You know, but we've also seen companies like Dental Corp, for example, come public, you know, arguably a mature industry consolidating story, and, you know, they had a very successful IPO also. So, you know, we've got quite a few companies in that category. I'd also probably layer in, and it's not specific to an industry, but, you know, we're kind of in a later stage of a cycle with both venture capital investors and private equity investors, where they had made some investments and helped companies mature. Thesis a couple of years ago was a lot of these companies should have been coming public, but they're maturing a lot longer under the auspices or the sort of umbrella of private equity. And they're making it to the market now. And so there's a turnover of capital with venture capitalists and private equity sponsors in terms of getting their companies public and liquidating some of their investments.
How much of that pie is sustainable financing? And what's driving that? Is it investor pressure or is it the companies themselves?
You know, so far, Larissa, it's not as big a part of the financing pie as you would think. And by that, I mean, there a lot of the sustainability, and, you know, by that, I'm implying climate-oriented sustainability, being, you know, companies that are addressing the transition in energy over a long period of time. The primary beneficiaries of that theme, and it's an incredibly powerful theme in the markets. All investors are looking at that, whether it's for altruistic reasons or purely commercial reasons. Like, that is where the world is heading. There is going to be one of the greatest shifts in capital that we've seen since the Second World War, probably, in terms of capital moving towards, you know, rebuilding an entire sector towards a lower carbon footprint. Really, the only public companies to benefit from that to date have really been the renewable energy companies, of which there are very many in Canada and the United States. Those are the public players. The utility companies, which are obviously a lot larger, have raised quite a bit of capital and have extraordinary amounts of capital available to them to be able to finance that transition. So those are the two key beneficiaries. We're just at the cusp of seeing some exciting new technologies come to the markets. in the form of smaller companies with evolving technologies that could be, as I mentioned, very exciting going forward. They're just not there yet. But we certainly know that that's where this is all going.
I want to pick up on something that you had just touched on with respect to IPOs. We heard a lot of noise coming out of the U.S., not so much in Canada. Does Canada have the supply? Does Canada have the healthy companies that it needs to come to market? What is CIBC seeing when it comes to Canadian IPOs?
Well, we certainly have a very busy calendar of Canadian companies coming public. You know, I think you have to dissect that comment a little bit. We've seen healthy Canadian companies go public for a long period of time. There was a period where they decided to go to the United States to go public. And what we're seeing now is more of these companies going public in Canada, at a minimum cross-listing, so they get a bit of both, but they're going public in Canada successfully, getting great liquidity, getting a strong shareholder base, and they don't need to go to NASDAQ or the New York Stock Exchange, for example. And so that's what we're seeing. It's a very vibrant VC community in Canada. I think you need to look back at, you know, the chain of supply, if you will, and it starts with the venture capitalists, you know, the seed investors and upwards. And that community has exploded, if you want to use that type of adjective for the amount of volume that's going and growth. And so there's a lot of money being raised in Canada to finance these companies. You know, various levels of government have also been supportive in that regard. And so I think we're at the cusp of seeing more of this momentum. I am optimistic, but then I also don't see why that would change. You know, the world from a finance perspective is much more comfortable with, you know, regional exchanges that provide great liquidity in a global context.
Canada saw some robust activity when it came to M&As. Where do you see consolidation happening? I mean, we saw some activity in some of the gold mining companies and Canada's oil and gas sector. Where do you see this headed?
Kind of a two-part answer, Larysa. I think part A, larger companies lowering their cost of capital, lowering their cost of inputs or capital, and so scaling. From that perspective, as we mentioned earlier in the conversation, cost of capital has declined, and so they're taking advantage of that to scale. And you see that with some of the large big ticket M&A transactions in the market. The second part of that would be growth, where companies can acquire technology that they wouldn't otherwise be able to grow in-house. And so we're seeing, you know, smaller M&A deals that are leading and build company building type of deals that bulk up a company through the acquisition of talent or technology. So kind of a two driving forces leading the M&A charge here.
Roman, you started off this conversation talking about trends, and curious to get your take on what underlying trends you see playing out the second half of 2021.
Continued cost of capital around here. Like my partners, Avery Schenfeld or Benny Tal, would do a better job of getting into the interest rate discussion, but doesn't feel as though it's going to be that far from where we are right now. You know, we've got a bit of a stasis in the market, if you will, of everyone waiting to see how the recovery will unfold. And so the markets are being driven within a fairly narrow band, actually, by news, be it the unemployment news, be it the inflation news. You know, inflation is often cited as one of the great risks to the market right now, but inflation is actually a very healthy sign of growth for the revenue lines for many clients that are coming to the markets. So it's a bit of a trade-off that way. So it appears as though the volume should continue. There might be a fatigue in that, you know, any client who's needed to raise money has pretty much done it and is waiting for, you know, opportunities to do so, you know, in the case of debt, maturities to roll over, or in the case of equity for other opportunities for acquisitions or sell downs of secondary positions to continue.
global economies seem to be somewhat out of sync as reopenings happen at different times around the world. Is that on your radar? Does that concern you at all?
It concerns me if it concerns my clients, to be honest. And I think a lot of our clients are looking at this in the lens of what does it mean for their global operations and opportunities. But generally speaking, I think most corporate management teams see through the end of the pandemic, and they're looking a year or two or three or longer out to sort out their businesses. And so like clearly there are some black swan events that folks always have in the back of their minds. And so that's there. And that, you know, there are probably more black swans today than there were in people's minds than there were a year or two ago, just having lived through one. But I don't think it really affects base decision making that way. Like I said, they're thinking a little longer here. And you know, a lot of models have changed for people, meaning how would the world react to a worst case scenario? Well, we've sort of been through a worst case scenario, right? So how does that affect our business and that sort of thing? Clearly the world continues to globalize, to digitize and evolve that way, which is a great opportunity for a lot of our clients.